Welcome back. This is the second video of section 4.3, in which we are going to prove our first compactness result, known as Banach Alaoglu-Bourbaki theorem. It's very simple to state. It states that the closed unit ball of the dual of no space is weakly star compact, or compact for the weak star topology. So the strategy to prove this is to embed E star in a bigger space. And this space is just the space of all functions from E into R, whether continuous or not, linear or not. Because recall that E star by definition is the set of all linear maps from E into R that are continuous in the normal topology or in the weak topology, doesn't matter. Okay, and R to the E is by definition a product space. Okay, so we equip the space with the product topology. And this topology has a name, so it's called the topology of pointwise convergence. Why? Because convergence in the product topology is equivalent to pointwise convergence of a sequence of functions. And we did this discussion in chapter zero. Okay. By definition, the product topology on this bigger space is the smallest topology making all projections continuous. Okay. And by a projection here, I mean I denote by pi sub x, which to each element in REF associates its value at the point x. Okay. So here, okay, we denote f any element in R to the E, not just necessarily linear or continuous. Okay. So I suggest that you go back to the discussion of chapter zero in order to follow the proof. Okay, so therefore, by definition, E star is a subset of this bigger space R to the E. Okay. Now, we have, therefore, four topologies on E star. The norm topology that you know, the weak topology, the weak star topology that we defined earlier, and now we have a fourth topology, which is the subspace topology. So any subset of a topological space inherits a topology called the subspace topology. And it's by definition what? It's a set belong to this subspace topology if it is the intersection of E star with an open subset of R to the E. This is the subspace topology that we discussed in chapter zero. Okay, so our first target here is to prove that the third topology, the weak star topology, and the subspace topology coincide. Okay, and this is not terribly difficult. There are at least two ways of proving this. One way is the following. I go back to the definition or to the characterization of open sets in the weak topology, weak star topology, and open sets in the subspace topology. Okay. What does it mean to say that a subset U of E star is open in the weak star topology? It means that it's an arbitrary union of basis elements. And the basis element is just a finite intersection of sets of this form, jx minus 1 of Ox, where each Ox is open in R. Okay, this follows from the discussion in section 4.1. Okay, and on the other hand, a set in R to the E is open also if it is an arbitrary union of basis elements. But the basis element for the product topology is just a product of open sets, where almost all these sets are equal to R. So Ox equal to R except for X in a finite set A. This is the definition of the basis of the product topology. Okay. Now, when we restrict this topology to E star, so we have to intersect a basis element with E star. Okay. So the target is to prove that U and E star intersected with O are the same thing. Okay, so and it, for this, it's enough to prove that a basis element of this form is equal to a basis element of this form intersected with E star. Okay, and then because they will have the same union. Okay. Okay, so this is E star intersected with O is a typical element in the subspace topology inherited from R to the E. Okay. So, therefore, E star intersected with O is an arbitrary union of sets of this form, E star intersected with the basis element. Okay. So I just have to prove that this a set of this form is equal to a set of this form, and then I will take the union. Okay. So now, let us consider the intersection of E star with a basis element in the product topology of R to the E. What's that? An element is here if and only if it belongs to E star, and the projection of at x of f belongs to Ox, which is precisely means that f of x belongs to Ox for every x in E. Okay, this is the definition of a product of sets. Okay. Now, since Ox is R except for x in a finite set A, this means that f of x belongs to Ox for every x in E is equivalent to saying that f of x belongs to Ox for every x in A. Because if x is not in A, then necessarily f of x belongs to R, so it belongs to Ox. Okay, so these two conditions are equivalent. Okay, because Ox equal to R if x is not in A. And now, by definition of the canonical injection J, f of x is by definition jx of f. Okay. So and we can write this in two ways, jx of f or jx comma f between brackets, same thing. Okay, what does it mean that jx of f belongs to Ox? It means that f belongs to jx minus 1 of Ox. Okay. And this is true for all x in A, so this is just the intersection of inverse images. And therefore, we prove that a basis element in the subspace topology is equal to a basis element in the weak star topology. And therefore, when I take unions, I get the same result. So therefore, the two topologies are the same. Okay, so it's just a simple result. Okay, so therefore, now we'll prove that the closed unit ball of E star is compact in the bigger space R to the E. And now this becomes easier. Why? Because I write the E star as the set of elements in R to the E that are linear, so they satisfy these equations, f of x plus y equal f of x plus f of y, and homogeneity, and they are bounded, and their norm is 1, is less or equal than 1. So this is equivalent to saying that, so an element is in this closed unit ball, if and only if it's linear, and satisfies this inequality, f of x in absolute value is less or equal than absolute value of x. So this is by definition. And now, therefore, we can write B of E star, the closed unit ball, as an intersection of two sets. First one is K1, which is just embed this conditions, f of x in absolute value is less than norm of x for every x in E. And by the way, this is not a subset of E star because I didn't assume any linearity on F. And the second one actually is the set of just linear maps, okay, and not necessarily continuous. So B star is the intersection of these two sets. Now, the first set is actually a product of closed intervals minus norm of X, norm of X. So it's a product of compact spaces. And by the Tikhonov theorem, it's itself compact. And therefore, of course, closed, because R to the E is Hausdorff, as you know, because it's a product of Hausdorff spaces. Okay, and K2 is not necessarily compact, but it's closed. Why? Because I can write K2 as an intersection of inverse images of closed sets. Okay, so you may easily check that F belongs to K2 if and only if pi X plus y minus pi x minus pi y of f is 0. This is the first condition. And pi alpha x minus alpha pi x of f is 0. So we can write this k2 as an intersection, an infinite intersection of closed sets. Therefore, k1 intersected with k2 is a closed set in R to the E, but it lives in a compact space, which is k1. So it's a closed set of a compact set or a compact space. Therefore, it is itself compact. And therefore, B star is compact in the product topology, and therefore in the weak star topology, because they are the same. So this concludes the proof of Banach Alaoglu-Bourbaki, a central result, fundamental result in functional analysis. Okay, now, first remark, sometimes use pi x, sometimes use jx. Pi x and jx are mainly the same thing because they both evaluate f at the point x, but they have different domains, different source spaces. Jx is defined just on E star, whereas pi x is defined on the bigger space R to the E. Okay. So this is the first remark. And the second remark is that we can, another way to prove that the subspace topology inherit from the product topology and the weak star topology, sorry, this is weak star, not weak, is a homeomorphism, okay? And I proved that in the lecture notes, okay? If you understood the proof here, it's fine, but you have an alternative proof in the lecture notes. So please correct that. This is weak star, not weak. Okay, and now to test your understanding, I suggest that you prove this corollary. In a dual space, a set is weakly star compact if and only if it is weakly star closed and bounded. So we have two implications. A weakly star compact set is necessarily, of course, a compact set in Hausdorff space is closed. So you just have to prove that it's bounded. And for this, you have the uniform boundedness principle as a tool. And conversely, you take an arbitrary bounded and weakly closed set, and we prove that it is weakly star compact. Okay, using corollary 4.4. Okay, so take a paper and a pen, and just do it. Okay, to test your understanding. And okay, so I may give you this in the exam actually. So it's a good way to prepare yourself for the exam. So it's not terribly difficult. So you have all the tools. Okay. So, yeah. So this concludes this video and section 4.3. So thank you for your attention and see you next time.